that's not in here, and we'll be recording that the audio so that we will you can listen to that a little bit later on. We're excited to have Dr. Clary here with us. Said that right, Dr. Clary? And he's going to be speaking to us. How many of you love dinosaurs? Dinosaur. How many of you love Jurassic Park? All right. He may squish our whole idea of Jurassic Park. So just prepare. I'm preparing my heart. I have no clue. But these wonderful replicas are up here as well. And we're just excited. At the end of this, he's going to give time for any question and answers. And so what they'll do is we'll have that time. And if you have a question, if you'll just come up to the microphone at the end and ask that question, we'd be glad to do it. Please take notes. You see me on my phone. I'm not on Facebook. Actually, I kind of am on Facebook because I'm doing some moderating there with those online. But I'm mostly taking notes. So I encourage you to take notes using your phone or whatever you might need there. So without further ado, can we welcome tonight Dr. Clary tonight?
Louis, is this usually advanced?
Pastor Jeremy, is the right means to go forward?
There's no pointer on this.
All right, and then is there a pointer on that?
There is at the very top.
There it is. Okay. That
works? Works over our nose, no.
All right. That works?
Those are too bright. Yeah, that's okay. Great. All right, that's great. No, it's going to be fine. All right, well, welcome everybody that's came back. Some people went home apparently, or else they followed my colleague Frank Sherwin. But I am Dr. Tim Clary. I'm the geologist at ICR, and I've been with them about 8 years now, almost 8 years. And it's been a pleasure. I tell people all the time I have the best job in the world because I get to teach people and tell people that the Word of God is true. All the research that I do shows that God's Word really is true. And so if you can believe some of the things in Genesis, but you can believe anything. And so tomorrow I'll be talking about the global flood. And the evidence for the global flood that I'm finding all over the world, study continent by continent by continent. Some of you that follow the Acts and Facts may see some of my articles in that that talks about it, but tomorrow we'll kind of summarize it all. But today we get to talk about one of my favorite things, my favorite subjects in the world, and that is dinosaurs. And so we have these replicas up here, as your pastor said. This is, which dinosaur is this? Anybody know? T-Rex, right. This is a Tyrannosaurus Rex skull. This is from Stan, which was found by a guy named Stan. So the dinosaur wasn't really named Stan. But this is one of the most complete skulls in all the world. And it has these big, huge teeth, and you can see they always had new teeth coming in, just like sharks. So teeth were coming in on these things. So that's why they're different lengths, because they have different stages of the teeth coming in. So they lose teeth throughout their lifetime. That became a meat eater after the fall of Adam and Eve. So we'll talk about that in a minute. Originally, that thing ate plants, and that's all it ate. God designed that to eat plants, just like all animals. This was a plant eater even after the fall. This is, anybody know the name of this one? Triceratops. Yes, I heard it over there. Triceratops. This is one of the ceratopsians, they call them, or the horned and frilled dinosaurs. So they have these big horns coming off the eyes over here. T-Rex could look right at you. This dinosaur could look to the side. Couldn't really look straight ahead. Those horns got in the way. But this thing could look right at you, we think, like, and see 3D just like you and I see. So even though in Jurassic Park, in the first movie, they say, don't move, he can't see you, he could see you, or she could see you. We don't know which is male or female either. So that might have been a big female, might have been a big male. It's very, very difficult to tell reptiles from the bones. But before we get too carried away, I suppose I want to talk tonight. I want to talk about, do dinosaurs really support evolution? Because you hear a lot about dinosaurs, how they evolved from this or they turned into this. And Dr. Frank Sherwin talked about, the idea today is that dinosaurs evolved into birds. That's what you're taught in school. So if you go to public schools or you watch TV, or if you watch Jurassic Park, the new movies particularly, they'll talk about how dinosaurs and birds are the same thing. Well, at ICR, we don't agree with that at all. And the evidence really doesn't support that, as you'll see as we go along. So we'll see. Many people have a lot of questions about dinosaurs. Aren't dinosaurs millions of years old? As a Christian, attending church week after week, you start wondering, where do dinosaurs fit in the Bible? How do they fit, and did they go in the ark? Did they really exist? I've had students that told me they don't think dinosaurs even exist. Well, I can assure you they existed. We can find the bones that these replicas are made from. I've had the pleasure to dig up bones in a few places in Wyoming and Montana. And this is one of my trips out there. I was going out with my daughter, and we found a green dinosaur right at the gas station. It's called a Sinclair gas station. And it was kind of humorous because usually I show this slide, and gasoline was $2 a gallon, which was really rare. Now it's back. You know, back at the time when this was taken, in the 90s, early 90s, late 90s, that wasn't so unusual. And it went up to $4 a gallon, and in California it hit $5 or $6 a gallon, then it's come back down because they found so much more oil. But oil, I'll talk about tomorrow, oil is also a product of the flood. It's not from dinosaurs, it's really from marine algae. But let's move right along. What does the Bible say about dinosaurs? Well, you won't find the word dinosaur in the Bible. We'll talk about why that is in a minute. But it does say in Genesis 1:25, it says, God made the beast of the earth according to its kind. So Frank talked about all the animals are made according to their kind. Well, the beast of the earth includes the dinosaurs. So all these other animals that God doesn't list every animal, he just says in the beast of the earth. And it says dinosaurs were also, like all animals, created to eat plants. So even though this dinosaur has teeth that later were very good at ripping apart other dinosaurs, because we do see the teeth marks in the bones, we see the teeth broken off in the bones that healed over. So they're eating dinosaurs while they were alive, some of them survived. We can see these things were eating dinosaurs, but originally they didn't. They ate particular plants that God provided around the earth. And that thing continued to eat plants. But unfortunately, they are all extinct today. But dinosaurs did get on the ark because God didn't exclude any kind of animal. There's no exclusions in the Bible. All land animals, every kind of land animal, God brought them all to the ark. And he says in Genesis 6, creatures that moved along the ground, two of every kind, and their food. So he didn't bring other dinosaurs for them to eat. He brought the vegetation that these dinosaurs ate on the ark. So horses eat hay, dinosaurs ate grass, some of them. Some of them ate other plants. T-Rex ate plants as well. Even though after Adam and Eve sinned, they started eating each other, they still could revert back to eating plants. Even today, they find crocodiles, and they cut them open to study them, and they find all sorts of plants inside their stomachs. And the secular scientists who don't believe in God's word, you know, they believe in evolution, they go, how come these things are eating plants? It's not crocodiles, they only ate dogs and chickens and whatever, you know, meat they could get a hold of, but they actually do eat a lot of plants even to this day. So God designed all animals to eat plants. Food was plants on the ark. And then in Genesis 7, it says, everything on land perished that had the breath of life. These had the breath of life. They had nostrils up here. They had a couple extra holes in here, but they had nostrils in here as well. And so in the nose, the eyes, the nose, same thing in the T-Rex. The nose is at the very front. There's other holes in there called fenestra, just a light in the skull. God designed these perfectly the way they are. And you'll see they just showed up that way. So here's the eye socket back here. These are holes that God put in here. But yet he made the skull strong. He was able to put structural holes in there to lighten the skull. Because it's such a big skull, if that was solid bone, like that one's almost all solid bone, it wouldn't be able to hold its head up very well. So his design, even in the dinosaurs, God had to design them all. So here's the ark. The ark was at least 450 feet long based on the cubit and the dimensions given in the Bible, 75 feet wide and 45 feet high with three different levels. Plenty of room to hold thousands and thousands and thousands, two of each of every kind of animal. Again, like Frank said, not every dog, but a pair of dogs to represent all the dog kind. A pair of tyrannosaurs to represent all the tyrannosaur kind. A pair of ceratopsians to represent triceratops and others. All were brought on the ark, but not each species, so to speak, but each kind. And we actually did the math at ICR. Nobody had done the math until we said, let's do it. Because who doesn't like math, right? Math is fun. And so we did the math, and we counted out 350 dinosaurs, and we went through and looked at the weight of all those dinosaurs, did the statistics, and figured out the average weight of a dinosaur, an adult dinosaur, weighed about the same as an American bison or a buffalo. So they were pretty big, but not that big. But the juvenile dinosaurs were much smaller. And so God probably brought juveniles on the ark instead of full-sized dinosaurs. And there's only about 60 or maybe 70 kinds of dinosaurs. There's not that many kinds. It's a lot of variety, but not a lot of kinds. Frank talked about this as well. There's two worldviews out there, pretty much. There's those that reject God's word and those that accept God's word. And there's some people that try to do a little bit of both. But the two extremes are you believe God's word wholly, or you believe in a story made up by humans called uniformitarianism. Uniformitarianism is a big long word that just says everything's uniform. That there's always been volcanoes, there's always been earthquakes, there's always been all these things that we experience today, but they stretch it over millions and billions of years. And the Bible doesn't talk about millions or billions of years, nor does the scientific evidence support millions and billions of years, as we'll see later. But they reject God, they think everything, you know, had to have its beginning, everything continues on, and God even wrote about this in 2 Peter. But if you look at Exodus 20, the actual hand of God, when he wrote the Ten Commandments, handed them to Moses, he said, "And for in 6 days the Lord made the heaven, the earth, the sea, and all that is in them." If these were six long periods of time, God would have said, "For in six long periods of time, the Lord made the earth, the heaven, and the sea," but he did it in 6 days. And the Genesis account talks about that as well. Six 24-hour days. There was morning, there was evening the first day. There was morning, there was evening the second day. There's no evidence that there were these long periods of time. And it doesn't fit the geology anyway, because he didn't make, God made the sun and the moon on day four, but yet he made plants on day three. So up until God made the sun, of course, God had to provide the light. And that was only one day. And then he made the animals and the dinosaurs later. 2 Timothy 4:4 says this, and this is kind of a prediction of the world today, where God knew what people were going to believe. He said, "And they shall turn away their ears from the truth of God's word, and shall be turned unto fables." So today, what you hear in public schools, what you hear in the public TV shows, what you hear when you go to national parks, you hear the fables made up by mankind that talks about evolution. Fables based on no real science at all. And the Greek word for fables, of course, is where we get our word myth. So we got to bust these myths. We got to consider uniformitarianism as the biggest myth of all. And it's everywhere, just like the water in a sponge. It's in the movies you watch. It's in the Jurassic Park movies you watch. Right off the bat, they talk about 66 million years ago, 65 million years ago. They sneak these numbers in there. They figure if they repeat it enough, people are going to believe it. And it works on a lot of people. They start believing these stories. But we need to squeeze those lies out, the lies of deep time. They don't exist. The facts are what's real, and the rocks are the facts. Rocks are real. You can go and touch them. This is me when I was much younger. I had a dark mustache. My wife doesn't recognize me anymore, do you? Thought with mustache. The rocks don't lie. People do. People are who lie. People make up stories. People make up evolutionary stories. But the rocks don't support it at all, as we're going to see tonight. Now, why the word dinosaur is not in your Bible is because the word dinosaur wasn't invented until 1841. Sir Richard Owen, this happy-looking guy here. So you look like your grandfather when you spill something on his carpet? Kind of reminds me of my great-grandfather. Anyway, back in 1841, Sir Richard Owen, who didn't believe in evolution, by the way, he never accepted Darwinian evolution through his lifetime. He's the one that said, there's a new type of reptile out here called dinosaurs that walk erect. Their legs come straight down. So if you look at this particular diagram here in the middle, you can see the light in the left-hand side. Dinosaur legs come straight down. They don't sprawl like reptiles today. Turtles, crocodiles, everything else sprawls, and they wallow around in the mud, dragging their bellies. Dinosaurs don't drag their bellies. They didn't drag their tails. They walk erect, whether they're two-legged or four-legged, and that's what made them different than all their reptiles. Now, unfortunately, it appears dinosaurs are extinct today. Even though they got off the ark, they went extinct in the 4,000 or so years since the flood, and they didn't do well in the post-flood world. But there's no word dinosaur in your Bible because the Bible was translated into King James in 1611, over 200 years before the word dinosaur came into existence. So you can fill in beast of the earth, or sometimes the Bible talks about dragons. Many times those are actually dinosaurs, we believe. So there's the myths we want to talk about. One, of course, is that dinosaurs, people will tell you if you read a textbook, you pull up a dinosaur book, not this one, of course, but most dinosaur textbooks will talk about dinosaurs were buried slowly in mud, and we'll see that's kind of a myth as we go through this. There's also a myth that dinosaurs have all these ancestors, and that scientists have found all the ancestors. You'll see that's a myth too. And third, dinosaurs are thought to today evolve into birds, and that people actually claim that dinosaurs are birds. And the dinosaurs had feathers, and we'll look at some of this as well briefly in this talk. And finally, that dinosaurs are millions of years old, that they existed on the Earth first 230 or so million years ago and went extinct about 66 million years ago. Now, if you heard this talk 10 years ago, I would have said 65 million years ago. But scientists changed the time. You know, what's a million years between friends, right? A million years. It's nothing. So now it's 66 instead of 65. So you may see a few 65s in my talk. Those are supposed to be 66. Let's look at these. Let's look at the dinosaurs buried slowly. Myth number one. This is from a book that Dr. Bob Bakker wrote, who's a famous dinosaur paleontologist, in a book called The Dinosaur Heresies. He said, after 6 months or a year or two, the monsoon rains return, the level of the lake rises, spreading a soft blanket of limey mud over the sun-dried bodies of this dead dinosaur. And that's kind of the story they tell you. Dinosaurs are buried slow. You know, there's a wet season, a dry season. They get thirsty and hot and die. And then they slowly, a year or so, 6 months later, they get buried. And then they become a fossil, almost miraculously, over millions of years later. Well, that's really a myth, because no animal survives if it isn't buried really, really quickly. I finally, after 60 years of life, I finally killed my first squirrel about a month or so ago, and I was pretty excited. Woohoo! Because I've been trying to get one for years. And I finally got one. I didn't even mean to. It ran into me. I'm like, oh, I wasn't aiming for him. Some of you are offended, but I really wasn't. But I never killed a squirrel before until I turned 60. I don't know what that means. But I finally killed a little thing. How long is that squirrel going to survive after it's dead? There'll be birds out there picking at it that day. And then it'll rot away. You can't leave animals, dinosaurs included, around for 6 months or a year or so just waiting to be buried. You have to bury things fast and deep. And even some of the paleontologists are now recognizing that, and we'll see the evidence supports that. When I dug dinosaurs in Wyoming and Thermopolis, we found these bone beds that were about the size of this whole room, and they're about this thick, filled with bones, like a big log jam of bones. You can see the bones on there, my hammer for scale. All these big leg bones of dinosaurs, but they're all piled on top of each other in a big flood. And they even say it's a big flood. They just don't think it's the flood. They just think a lot of local floods. But these are buried in a flood, and bone beds are very, very common. And dinosaurs are actually found with marine fossils as well. There's marine fossils mixed in with the dinosaurs, marine clams, and marine critters, and even marine fish in cases. If you look at the Hell Creek Formation in Montana, where you find all of these, almost every T-Rex ever found has been found in the Hell Creek Formation, because it has other names in different states, but they're all found in this. Jack Horner's found a bunch of them. This one was found up there as well. But notice that very first thing in yellow, there's six species of sharks found right with the T-Rexes. And in fact, where they pulled out T-Rex Sioux, the biggest T-Rex ever assembled in Chicago, found by the same guys, found by a lady named Sue. This one was found by a guy named Stan, so that's where they get the names from. Yeah, that was actually laid underneath where they pulled the bones out, they found shark teeth. So there's six species of sharks in the same rock layers. Now the secular scientists say, oh, those must have been all, you know, freshwater sharks. But they have no evidence of that. There's not many freshwater sharks today. Most sharks are marine. But there's also a lot of other things. There's bony fish that lived in the ocean, crocodiles, you know, dinosaurs in that, including T-Rex, including this thing, turtles, mammals, everything all mixed together, just what you'd expect in a big flood, washing in big waves from the ocean, mixing land and marine. And the more I study the rocks around the world, I see this in every continent, mixing of land and marine. The Europeans found all their dinosaurs are in marine rocks, like chalk and limestone. They found the dinosaurs mixed in chalk and limestone. And I thought that was an exception, but it's the rule that all their dinosaurs, pretty much, you found in Europe, are found in rocks that should be way out in the ocean. We've even found dinosaurs washed up 75 miles off Norway. They drilled an oil well 75 miles offshore. They drilled an oil well 1.5 miles down, pulled a rock core up, and in that rock core they found a dinosaur toe bone. 75 miles offshore, so these waves were coming in, washing in dinosaurs and marine fossils, mixing them all together and burying them. They were also washing back out. And that's exactly what tsunami waves do today. During the flood, you had huge tsunami waves that washed across big pieces of the continent, eventually the whole continent. I'll talk more about that tomorrow. Spinosaurus in Morocco, bigger than a T-Rex, 50 feet long, big, huge thing. You see it in Jurassic Park 3. I think T-Rex would have won when they fought, but that's just me. I think T-Rex is tougher. This had teeth like crocodiles. Really was more like a crocodilian animal. Probably did eat fish and swam in water. But this, what it's eating there are coelacanths. Coelacanths are fish we find today living in the oceans. But they're 500 feet down. They're nowhere near the surface even. But because they find coelacanth fish with spinosaurs in Morocco, they say all these must have been freshwater fish. But there's no evidence they're freshwater fish. These are marine fish that got washed in from 500 feet down all the way in and mixed with the dinosaurs. This mixing is what we see. The secular scientists will write down the lists, but they never make the point that how do all these things get mixed together? They try to twist the story and say these are non-marine sharks and non-marine fish, but yet today we find these same fish living in the ocean, in the Indian Ocean today, 500 feet down. We see immediate death positions like fish eating fish. These things are buried fast. We even see an ichthyosaur, let's say a swimming reptile, not a dinosaur, a swimming reptile that's extinct, giving live birth, buried instantly. That's how fast these waves came in. And my favorite is this one. Here's where I'm going to break another one of your Jurassic Park myths. I'm sorry, Pastor, but the velociraptor in that one is really only about this big. The velociraptor's skull is about this long. And we have a replica at our ICR in our Discovery Center of this battle between a protoceratops, which is kind of the same kind as this without the horns, but much smaller. And they were fighting, and they found these in Mongolia. And you can see the velociraptor's arm is in the mouth of the protoceratops. And it's about to bite down, and they were buried instantly. So it's like two WWE wrestlers going at it in the chokehold, and they got buried instantly, frozen that way for thousands of years until they were excavated by some Polish scientist in the 1970s, I believe. That's an amazing discovery. This is a life assemblage, they call it. These things were alive, about to bite each other, and instantly buried. That's how rapid the burial is. So myth-busting number one is dinosaurs are not slowly buried. There's no slow burial. There's rapid burial. Everything has to be buried fast and deep. If you're not buried deep, you don't become a fossil, you rot away. So it can vary on the type of rock, but a bit deep enough. Let's move on to number two. Dinosaurs have many ancestors. You hear this all the time. There's always news articles coming out. We see them several times a year. New ancestor for Tyrannosaurus Rex. New ancestor for this. Well, do they really find them? Let's take a look. Let's look at sauropods. The long necks. The sauropodomorphs. This was a Seismosaurus replica. They found about 40% of this specimen because you rarely find complete dinosaurs. You only find just a few bones. This, they have found about 40% in New Mexico. They've kind of made a plastic replica and said, if we make this whole replica, how big would it be? And they said 131 feet long. So it wouldn't even fit in the sanctuary. This was a really, really old dinosaur. Probably hundreds of years old. Just like humans were hundreds of years old in the pre-flood world. Dinosaurs, the bigger they were, the older they were. This T-Rex, Stan, might have been 400, 500 years old. Secular science says, oh no. But the Bible tells us these things could live just like humans, really, really old. The older they got, the bigger they got. So this is a really, really big one. This is not the size that God probably would have brought on the ark. God would have brought juveniles that were probably 10 feet long or less on the ark. But this was a big, big animal. Sauropods are very unique. They have large body size because if you were big, you were safe. You don't kill adult sauropods if you're a predator. You kill the juveniles. You kill the young ones. Just like today, people don't attack adult elephants. People do, I guess. Animals don't attack adult elephants. They try to get the young ones. So the mothers are very protective of their babies because they have to protect them until they get big. So a big size is protection. They had a four-legged stance, a small head. If they had a big head on the end of one of these long necks, what would happen? See that little tiny head? It had a big head, it's just gonna fall over and lay on the ground all day long. and be like you guys tomorrow watching the football games. You guys just lay on the couch with your head because your head's too big. Well, God designed them perfectly with 10 or more neck bones. No animal today has 10 or more neck bones, 10 or more tail bones, etc. Elongate neck bones, even hollowed out neck bones. So God designed these. If you go back, if you look really carefully, God actually hollowed out the neck bones to make the neck lighter. So it's not so heavy. Just like he hollowed out the skulls of some of these dinosaurs to make them a little bit lighter as well. These are all intricately designed by our Creator. So if we look at these and look in the rocks, because the rocks don't tell lies, people do. If you look at the rocks and you look at these layers, most sauropods or long-necked dinosaurs are found in Jurassic rocks. They're in the middle. And those are the millions of years they're supposed to be. Don't believe those. But they're found in Jurassic rocks, and there's Cretaceous rocks above and Triassic rocks below. Well, if you look below for the ancestors of these, we don't see anything. If you look down those Triassic rocks, there's no long-necked dinosaurs. They just appear in the Jurassic, fully formed, big long tails, big long necks. We don't find half long necks. We don't find three quarters long necks. We don't find one quarter long necks. We find complete long necks and long tails, instantly formed. They just appear in the rocks, just as the order they were buried in the flood. Paul Sereno, an evolutionary paleontologist from Chicago, he said early on, again, I think researchers, and even maybe lay people, which is probably what most of you are, unless you're a dinosaur researcher. Maybe a dinosaur researcher here. Early on, researchers and lay people really felt we had more ancestors in the fossil record than we really do. He says, we don't have a lot of ancestors, we have a lot of twigs. They don't have any ancestors. There's no ancestors to sauropods. Let's look at ceratopsians, the same thing. So here's my daughter when she was younger. She's 30 now. She's a little older than this, but we were out there digging dinosaurs back in the 90s, and there's a triceratops skull at my alma mater, University of Wyoming, and just very similar to this one, in fact. So do they have ancestors? Well, there's lots of variety, just like we have lots of dog breeds, but there's only maybe one or two kinds of these ceratopsians. There's only one or two kinds of these things, but you get all sorts of horns, two horns, three horns, no horns, bumpy horns, rough horns, all sorts of colors. But when these are born, when they find the eggs of these dinosaurs, they all look the same. You can't tell. And it's only as they mature as adults that they get these distinctive horns, which is probably more why each family looks a little different. If you look around the room, everybody's got a little different color hair, different shape to their skull, a little different look to their face. You know, God loves variety, not only in us, but in all of his creation, including dinosaurs. It doesn't make them a separate species. They're just all the same kind. But if you look for ancestors to these, just like we looked for the sauropods, most of the ceratopsian dinosaurs, the horned dinosaurs, are found in Cretaceous rocks. If you look down in the rocks below in the Jurassic, where you find sauropods, you find nothing. There's no ancestors at all to these horned dinosaurs. They just show up fully formed in the Cretaceous. Boom. That was the level they were buried in the flood. Globally. We'll talk more about that tomorrow on my flood talk. Tyrannosaurus rex. This is the Sioux I spoke of earlier. This is Tyrannosaurus rex Sioux in the Chicago's Field Museum. I had a chance to see this a couple of times. 41 feet long, 90% complete. Probably not a female, but it's named Sioux because it was found by a lady named Sue Hendrickson. But it's probably a male. We can't tell for sure. To this adventure, well, I got a chance to dig on T-Rexes up in Montana back around 2000. I got to dig on a T-Rex tooth. You can see the tooth there by my hammer. Paul Sereno, again, the same guy from the University of Chicago, he said this, whenever we try to put the dinosaurs in the history of the theropod dinosaurs, the theropods are the supposed all meat eaters like those. He says, they have a long missing record. And we're going to find their record one of these days. So all these evolutionary scientists, they're looking and looking and looking for these ancestors. They claim there's ancestors, but yet when it comes right down to it, they still have nothing. They have twigs, they have a missing record, they have no ancestors to these dinosaurs. So how do they explain them? They have a difficult time trying to explain where these things came from. They don't know where dinosaurs came from. They just show up fully formed. There's no ancestors to T-Rexes either. You can look in the rocks. Most T-Rexes are found in Cretaceous rocks, just like these. You look down the rocks below, the Jurassic, there's no T-Rexes at all. Nothing even resembling a T-Rex. So they have no idea where they came from. So Dr. David Weishampel, who's looked at more dinosaurs probably than anybody in the entire world, studied them for his whole life. He said, from my reading of the fossil record of dinosaurs, which looking at all the fossils, there's no direct ancestors that have been discovered for any dinosaur species. You can read that again. No direct ancestors that have been found for any dinosaur species. Alas, he says, my list of dinosaur ancestors is an empty one. So when push comes to shove and you actually ask these guys, name an ancestor, they can't. They just show up in the order they were buried in the flood. The Bible talks about that in Genesis. Genesis 7, how the flood covered everything, all the high hills, everything was air-breathing, was dead by day 150 of the flood. The flood lasted over a year. My wife likes me to emphasize that because people think the flood was 40 days because they sing the songs. 40 days of rain, boy. That was just the start. Things got a lot worse after 40 days. And worse and worse, and we'll talk more about that tomorrow, but the dinosaurs were probably buried on days 80 and 90 and 100, maybe day 110. The water kept going higher and higher, buried their environment. And then it went even higher and buried the lions and tigers and bears. Oh my. Right? Because you don't find those are dinosaurs. They're higher than dinosaurs for the most part when they find their fossils. So that's myth busting two, is all fossils appear in the rocks without ancestors. Even the very marine fossils that we're supposed to evolve from just show up in the Cambrian, boom. And more show up in the Devonian, and more show up in all these different, these little systems they talk about all the time are just different levels of different fossils. As the rock waters went higher and higher, fossils just show up, they stay the same, that stasis, and then they disappear. There's no known ancestors to any dinosaur groups or any group at all. So we'll move on. Let's look at our third point, because some of you are getting really bored. Who's getting bored? See, there's some kids don't lie very well. I love it. Dinosaurs evolved into birds. That's what you hear if you go to school. If you haven't been to school in a while, this is what they're being taught. It's what they teach at college. It's really unfortunate because they're teaching lies, teaching myths that are based on no science at all. Let's look at that. Did dinosaurs have feathers? Now, in the Jurassic Park movies, they would have put feathers in all the dinosaurs. Jack Horner told me that, but he says it cost too much money in 1993 when they made that first movie. And then the subsequent movies, they didn't want to change the image of what the dinosaurs looked like, so they just put a few feathers on the top of their head. But they want to put feathers all over that Velociraptor. And there's no evidence of that. They want to put feathers all over Tyrannosaurus Rex, too, and you'll see paintings and drawings of it in your National Geographic. But they found recently that that's not the case at all. This is a real bird with feathers. This is Archaeopteryx. It was found in Jurassic rocks. So this was an animal that couldn't fly very well. It had a bony tail, flew about like a pheasant, so it couldn't stay in the air very long, so it was kind of buried in the flood earlier than even a lot of the dinosaurs. So this is actually found in rocks below many of the dinosaurs that are supposed to be the ancestors to birds, which is kind of weird. We'll come back to that later. This is what they call proto-feathers, or feathers that are evolving. So they find animals like the Cynoceropteryx. Can you say Cynoceropteryx? Cynoceropteryx, a little bitty critter. See those little hairy-looking things coming off? They're trying to say those are feathers. They're turned into feathers, but they're not quite feathers. Stephen Brissett says this, the bones of these species are covered with a thick, feathery fluff. Not quill pen feathers of living dinosaurs, but simpler, filament-like feathers that look like hair. Well, when it comes right down to it, and they studied these things more carefully, back in 2005, Alan Fiducia, who's a bird expert, he's an evolutionist, but he says, these aren't feathers, these aren't proto-feathers, these aren't even hair, this is just collagen in the skin. As you bury these things fast and squish them, the collagen in our skin, and in the skin of these animals, looked like feathers. And he mimicked this by doing real empirical science. He squished part of a dolphin, and he squished it in some sediments. He looked at it later, and he saw all these hairy structures that leached off that looked just like these things, like the hair off these dinosaurs. That's collagen, just like you see collagen coming off. There's no hair, hairy fluff on dolphins, but yet he found all this hairy-looking stuff coming off the edge. It's all collagen. These are real feathers. This is a bird, just like Archaeopteryx. It's not fluff. But unfortunately, most of our evidence comes from China. And as I studied China and the geology of China, I found it's very difficult to believe everything you read and what's coming out of China. China isn't always giving us the truth, even in their science. And so unfortunately, we have frauds that come out of China. And this is one you can find in 1999 in National Geographic. They did a big hour-long TV show. I remember I was teaching about dinosaurs at the time. And they found this specimen that they bought in Arizona at a rock and gem show for $70,000. They're supposed to be the missing link between birds and dinosaurs. They finally had what they were looking for, that transitional missing link fossil that Frank Sherman and I tell you doesn't exist. And sure enough, they CT scanned it later. They found it was just a bird glued to a dinosaur. That's all it was, a bird glued to a dinosaur. They thought it was a transitional fossil, made all this big deal up. So a year later, they had to write a little retraction in the back of National Geographic in 2000. They put a two-page retraction saying, hey, it wasn't our fault. Everybody believed it. They believed because they wanted to see. They wanted to believe it. They didn't look at the data carefully. So a guy at University of Texas CT scanned it. So Texas saved the day again. You should be proud of the UT. Once in a while, they get it right. And they showed that in red was a bird, in black was a dinosaur. They glued them together, and they fooled all the top paleontologists of the world. All of them. Because they just wanted to believe it. They found it's a fake. And in 2017, again, not that long ago, they found out that T-Rexes didn't have feathers. They found enough skin imprints to show that, without question, T-Rex has scaly skin. Yet you see books out there in your libraries, books that your kids are reading, showing T-Rexes with feathers. And they, in 2017, they said, no, that's crazy. There's skin. We've got hundreds and hundreds of skin imprints of dinosaurs. Hundreds of them, none of them show feathers. They finally had to admit T-Rexes didn't have feathers. It hurt them, but they had to admit it. Peter Weldoffer again, he said this, he's a curator of Bavarian State Collection in Munich. He says, sometimes science gets a headline, and a nice feathered dinosaur headline, things like that, in order to get attention. And in the end, to get support, to get financial support. So if you want to get some money, you start saying, oh, I found a new feathered dinosaur. In reality, you didn't. But you can kind of sell it that way and get money. It's all about money, research money. If you want to become a college professor, you got to get grants. You got to get money. So whatever the government is funding, you got to go along with it. If the government says, we're into climate change, oh, my research is finding climate change. Well, of course it is, because that's how you get money. They fund what the government wants to fund, and unfortunately what they want to fund is evolution. They want to fund climate change, all these things that you might have your doubts about, for good reason, because it's not always based on good science, particularly paleontology. The biggest problem I mentioned earlier is that the dinosaurs that are most bird-like are found in rocks above birds. So here we have, in the Cretaceous, there were the most bird-like dinosaurs are claimed to be, like the velociraptors and T-Rexes, but yet we find dinosaur or fully formed birds in the Jurassic rocks well below the Cretaceous. So let me explain that a little more carefully. How do they explain that? Well, they go through this ghost lineage stuff. So here's your bird-like dinosaurs, the raptors supposedly up there in the Cretaceous. In Jurassic, we find real birds like Archaeopteryx that could fly. So how do they explain that the ancestor, the bird, turned into a dinosaur or vice versa? They have to say, well, there's ghost lineages that go all the way down to an unknown ancestor below both of them. So we have dinosaurs here, they're bird-like, birds here, it's supposed to be the other way around. And there's 40 or 50 million years of their evolutionary time in between. So how do they, you know, they have to have birds evolving over and over and over. So they say, well, bird-like dinosaurs, birds, there had to be an ancestor down here to both. And so they call these unknown ancestors ghost lineages. They basically are making things up. When there's dashed lines, you're making things up in geology. But they have no other explanation. They can't explain why you have birds here in the rock record, and then above the birds are the bird-like dinosaurs. These are supposed to turn into birds, and you already had birds. You get what I'm saying? How do you do that? Well, they gotta say, well, there had to be an ancestor down here to both. We just haven't found it. How many of you think they're gonna find it? They never will. But they have to perpetuate their myth. And I've seen people give talks on this with a straight face. I don't know how they can get away with that. There's no science in that at all. You're just making something up. That's not science. Science is the real specimens. There's no real specimens at all of these. Gunter Vile admits this. He's a paleontologist. The dinosaurs in China are not the ancestors of the birds. Of course, they can't be because they're later than Archaeopteryx, which is their real bird. So the dinosaurs in China are found in Cretaceous rocks. Real birds are found here in Jurassic rocks. They can't be the ancestors, and yet we haven't found any evidence for these ancestors. He says, unfortunately. Well, why does he say unfortunately? Because it goes against his belief. But you're not going to find it. So you won't find a half T-Rex that looks like a chicken head on it like that. You don't have to worry about such things because they're not related. They're completely different kinds. God made birds on day 5 of creation. Flying and swimming things on day 5. Dinosaurs walked on land. They were made on day 6. Same day God made humans. It's all about the year, millions of years. Are dinosaurs really millions of years old? Well, in 2005, and actually before this, they found in a T-Rex thigh bone, one of these big animals, they cracked it open, and Mary Schweitzer dissolved away too much bone with acid, and she found all this soft, squishy stuff. See that first picture with the arrow way over there, A, on the left side? That was like a rubber band. It could stretch it and it snapped back. So if you watch the video on this, and there's some videos out there on YouTube, you can watch soft tissue of dinosaurs. There's original dinosaur proteins, original dinosaur blood vessels, original dinosaur blood cells and osteocyte cells, bone-making cells. And physical chemists have shown that these things can't last even a million years, let alone 68 million years, let alone 150 million, let alone 190 million. These are blood vessels that are supposed to be 195 million years old. And you can see all those little black dots, those are red blood cells. And those little wormy-looking things below, those are osteocyte cells. These are all original cells. These are not just imprints, these are the real things. They've tested the proteins over and over and over and found these are the real thing. So since 2005, there's been about 100 papers now, discoveries of original dinosaur proteins and cells and collagen. How can they be millions of years old? The evidence shows these things are only thousands of years old. They can't survive millions of years. The head of Mosasaur discovered this about 2007. They had the original proteins from the heart, the liver, the retina, and its eyes and scales. Original parts over and over and over. It's supposed to be 110 million years old. And they have no way to explain how these things could survive. But do scientists turn away from the years? Do they say these things aren't millions of years old? No. They just insist, well, we don't understand how these were preserved. But yet empirical science by physical chemists has shown these things cannot survive millions of years. Original parts of animals, doesn't matter if it's dinosaur or what, can't survive millions of years. So there's strong concrete evidence, some of the strongest in the world being found in the last 10, 15 years, showing dinosaurs really are just thousands of years old, that there really was a global flood just thousands of years ago. But yet you never hear that in public schools. If they mention these, they don't mention the significance of these, now they're called chemical fossils. There's even lots of evidence of humans and dinosaurs interacting after the flood. Because dinosaurs didn't go extinct 2 days after the flood, they probably survived until maybe 500, 600, 700 years ago. How do we know? We can look at some of these writings in the Bible. In Job 40 and Job 41 talks about behemoth and leviathan. If you read through the details, it sounds an awful lot like a dinosaur. Behold now behemoth, which I made with you, because God made humans and land animals on day 6 of creation week. So he made them along with humans. He eats grass like an ox, strength is in his loins, the force from the muscles in his belly. He moves his tail like a cedar. Now, unfortunately, in a lot of your Bibles, it'll say a crocodile or a hippopotamus. It's a crazy footnote. Cross that out. They're describing a dinosaur. People just don't want to grasp the concept that dinosaurs and humans live together. You hear about all these fire-breathing dragons and all these things and all these myths, but there's some basis truth to these things. And the Bible talks about behemoth. People didn't believe dinosaurs ate grass. They thought grass didn't evolve until after the dinosaurs went extinct. But sure enough, they found fossilized dinosaur dung in India. In 2005, they had 5 species of grass. And sure enough, it was a sauropod dinosaur that was leaving those fossilized dung behind. So it really is true. The Bible's never shown to be wrong. People scoffed at it for a long time, saying, oh, how can these dinosaurs eat grass? Can't be a dinosaur. But sure enough, they found they really did eat grass. You can believe your Bible, folks. Everything about it's true. There's even ancient artwork. I don't know if you can see that in Egypt. The Narmer palette shows these big long-necked animals and the legs are walking erect. Notice in all these drawings and carvings, the legs are erect. No animal today looks anything like this walking erect. Here's a Mesopotamian cylinder. They rolled it out. And you can see these long-necked dinosaur-looking things, just like the Seismosaurus I showed you. Intertwined necks, big long tails, big long necks. And notice the legs are erect. What animal had erect legs? Only dinosaurs, reptiles with erect legs. Mammals, but these don't look like any mammals I've ever seen. These look just like those sauropod dinosaurs. So for centuries after the flood, humans and dinosaurs were interacting, and they were drawing carvings of them and writing about them. You can even go to, trying to move it along, sauropods in Carlisle Cathedral. On the floor is a carving in England from 1478. That's not that long ago, showing these long-necked sauropods. People didn't recognize what these were. Of course, dinosaurs weren't even recognized as a separate type of reptile until 1841, 400 years later almost. And then if you go to Angkor Temple in Cambodia in the 11th or 12th century, they're not sure of the age, you can see this carving of what looks just like a Stegosaurus. See the plate sticking up on its back? The little head sticking way down? Stegosaurus made a fan shape. They're very thin animals, but when they turn sideways, they looked really big. That's how they scare off predators, I think, because they could turn sideways and they looked really big like a fan, and that's exactly what this carving was made like. Whoever made that must have seen a Stegosaurus. Whoever made those other carvings must have seen long-necked dinosaurs. That's not a problem if you're a creationist, because you believe that God's word is true and dinosaurs did live with humans before the flood, on the ark with the with Noah and his family members, and even after the flood for centuries before they finally went extinct. These soft tissues and these original proteins in the biblical worldview are not a problem at all, but they're a big problem for evolutionary scientists who want to insist the world is billions of years old and dinosaurs are millions of years old. But how do you explain these original proteins? How do you explain all this collagen refining dinosaur bones in now over 100 papers, 100 separate discoveries all over the world? In animals, some of the animals are supposed to be 500 million years old. There's soft worms that are supposed to be half a billion years old, and they're still soft, still original proteins. How can you preserve proteins that long? Well, you can't, but maybe for thousands of years. Fossils don't take a long time to form, they just take the right conditions, the right order of burial. Dinosaurs didn't evolve, they just were buried in the order of burial that they lived in. Different ecological zones, and I'll talk more about this tomorrow in my flood talk. There's no evolution taking place, there's just a sudden appearance of animals, fully formed, the way God designed them during the creation week, buried in the judgment of the flood. Now, how could you escape the flood if you were a human? You had to walk through the door of the ark. Noah preached and preached and preached as he built the ark. There's going to be a flood to judge the earth. There's going to be a flood to judge the earth. And yet only 8 people in the entire earth, there might have been a billion people on the earth at the time of the flood in 1600 years. Only 8 people believed that God was going to bring on a flood. Noah and his immediate family. There's room for thousands more people. By day 90 of the flood, those people were probably pretty desperate. By day 140, they were even more desperate. By day 150, you were dead. All air-breathing animals, including all humans on the earth, by day 150, the flood were dead. All they had to do was walk through that door of salvation. They were saved. Christ today is that open door of salvation for us, for you and for me. Christ is that open door. He came, God himself came to the earth, took on human flesh, let humans kill him. In a very horrific death on the cross, shed his blood. He willingly was that perfect lamb led to slaughter so we can have forgiveness of our sins. He loves us that much. He loves us more than you love your children. He's willing to forgive us if we just believe that Christ did it for us. That free gift of salvation, all we have to do is believe and accept him as our Lord and Savior. Just like people in the time of Noah just had to walk through that open door. Christ has opened that door to salvation for us. We just have to make that decision while we're here on this earth. They just choose Christ and not the ways of the world, not the evolutionary story. We didn't get here by evolution. We got here because God created us. And we're the descendants of those original created Adam and Eve. Kind of a little, you can go back to Noah as well. But Noah came from Adam and Eve. All those chapters of the Bible, the first book of Genesis particularly, tells us exactly what happened, where we came from. And the secular community is telling us not to believe it. Don't believe it, don't believe it. We'll give you the answers. But they have no answers. They just have stories. The rocks, the fossils, all support the Bible, all confirm the Bible. God's word is true. The earth is only about 6,000 years old. And there's nothing in science, real science, that tells us otherwise. Those age dates, those are all built on piles and piles of assumptions. When they age date things they know the age of, they never get the right answer. But that's another talk in itself. I'm going to have to quit there. Remind you that dinosaurs are buried rapidly in the flood, like all fossils. Dinosaurs did not have ancestral forms. Nobody has found any ancestors to any dinosaurs. Dinosaurs did not evolve into birds, because we already had birds before dinosaurs. Even if you believe the rocks are telling you the right story, it's hard to justify saying dinosaurs turned into birds when you have birds buried here, and dinosaurs are supposedly bird-like up here. You know, why? It should be the other way around. It's kind of like having the grandchild before the grandfather. Hard to do. Dinosaur fossils are only 4,500 years old. That's, if you count back the genealogies, that's about what the flood was. About 1,600 years after the creation. If you want to know more about dinosaurs, I have a whole book back there for sale on this. I put my blood, sweat, and tears into this. It's really, the pictures are quite outstanding. Turned out better than I thought. But it's got a lot of information there. It even talks how they fit in the flood. And so it's got a little bit of my research on the flood in here as well, but it really talks about every type of dinosaur. And we have a lot of children's books as well back there on dinosaurs for younger ones. My wife and I wrote this book, Big Plans for Henry, because we had grandkids and there's no books for the grandkids to read. She was a kindergarten teacher for many years, and every Christian school, she had to cross out the millions of years in the books. So this one talks about thousands of years. It gives us a little story you can read to your grandkids between 4 to 7. It's a nice little story dedicated to our grandkids. There's a video, I didn't get to show any video clips tonight. I normally have video clips, but we had to convert all our files to PDF, so I cut all my video clips out. But this is an outstanding four-part DVD series on dinosaurs, lots of wonderful computer animations. And the third video in here talks all about those soft tissues and original proteins and how they're such a baffling mystery to the evolutionary scientists, because they don't want to accept that the world is young. But that's what the facts really support. And then there's a little lower level book than this one. This is more like junior high and high school. This is more like upper L and facts about dinosaurs. I wrote a chunk of this book as well. And then if you don't buy any other book in this whole weekend series, this is the book I would get. This just came out new and revamped and rewritten. It was about 80 new pages. So if you had the old one, you just need to pick up the new one. This is still $10. It's the best deal we have, $10. It covers everything, dinosaurs, covers astronomy, you know, why there's no evidence of the Big Bang, talks about biology, how humans and chimps are not even close to each other. We're about 80% alike, not 98%. That's what the genetics really supports. All that's in this book for $10. You need this if you're going to college. You need this if you're going to high school. If you got grandkids and kids going to high school and college, that's the book you need. You know, if you love dinosaurs, maybe pick up this. But there's a little bit about dinosaurs in that as well. So if you have enough money to buy one book, I think you said this earlier, Pastor, that's the book I'd pick up. But thank you very much, and this is free. Our monthly Acts and Facts is free. Just sign up. We'll send it to you every month for free. We don't sell your name to anybody else. And if you don't want to get any more, just tell us. We'll take you off the list. But this is free. We have a Discovery Center Museum, which will be open again hopefully in spring up there in Royal and Luna. If you're up that way, some of you might have gone to that. We're kind of closed down right now for COVID. There's some issues with COVID, apparently, in the world. And so we're kind of doing some remodeling on some things. So if you have been there before, you'll see some new things when you come back. If you've never been there, it's a wonderful experience. We got a big, huge T-Rex, 40-some feet long, that growls and roars. And we'll scare these kids till they cry. Because it scares me. And I, you know, he knows me, kind of like a pet. By the way, it's free if you sign up for Acts and Facts. So thank you very much, and I'll be here for some Q&A. And tomorrow I'll talk about the flood at 10 a.m. and then the ice age at 11. Why was there an ice age? God has a reason for everything. We'll see tomorrow. Thank you.
Amen. Anybody have any questions? We're going to give you, we got a little bit of time to ask a question. Who's got a question? Come on. Any kids have a question?
I couldn't have answered all your questions.
Can you answer? All right. If you'll come up here so that way our live stream can hear your question. And then if you have a microphone right there as well.
Where do mammals come into the fossil strata?
Oh, we start seeing mammals the same time we see dinosaurs. So there's a period in time, kind of, which I call the Ipsarica mega sequence, right around the Triassic. In the middle of that, kind of, you see about the same time you see dinosaurs appear in the rocks, we see mammals. But those mammals are like squirrels and beavers, wetland type mammals. We don't see the higher elevation mammals that like drier land until later. But we see mammals mixed with dinosaurs because you're burying land environments. There were some mammals in there with the dinosaurs as well. But most of them were kind of small wetland type things.
One more time, can you explain why different animals were found in the different layers?
Well, they named the layers with all the different names like Jurassic and Cretaceous based on changes in the fossils. And I believe it's all because of what I like to look at is called ecological zonation. And so as I'll show tomorrow, the flood didn't flood everything right away. It started flooding shallow seas first, and that's why we see marine fossils first. All over the world, we see almost the same fossils everywhere on every continent. And then as the water went higher, we get the swampy areas, like the dinosaurs and some of the swampy mammals, like squirrels and beaver type things. And as the water went higher, we see the upland animals, you know, basically the animals that lived at highest elevation, which might have only been 4,000 or 5,000 feet. You didn't have the big mountains until after the flood. That's when most of the world's mountains popped up, like Mount Everest. But I believe it's ecological zonation explains a lot of what we see in the rock record. So it's not evolution, it's just different environments.
Higher up would be the Triceratops?
Well, even above that. So most of the mammals, like camels and pigs and horses, they're found in rocks above the dinosaurs because they lived in higher elevation. So these things might live between maybe 1,000 feet above sea level or less, and then you go higher, you get things that live 2,000, 3,000. Even the dinosaurs are well stratified. We don't find these in rocks below Cretaceous. We don't find them in Jurassic. We don't find them in Triassic. But we see different dinosaurs that live really close to the coast. We see coal forming at the same time. There's no coal in the rock record until you start finding animals. That's when coal shows up. You might get a few streaks, but major coal seams start showing up the same time you start getting animals showing up, because now you're flooding the land. So I think tomorrow I'll explain more about that in the flood if you come back at 10. Yes, sir.
Hi. Is there any examples of humans and dinosaurs as far as fossils go?
Not that we know of. And again, I think part of the problem is that humans lived at higher elevation. And humans were made in God's image. Humans are the smartest. At least most of us are, right? Some of, and I think they either ran to high elevation. They had plenty of time to get up there. I think they might have been living there, most of them, and many of them are found at higher elevation because they ran there over the 150 days that the flood went all the way to the top. And so humans, many of them might have survived till day 120, day 130, you know, right up to day 150. Most of the humans were still probably alive, fighting with each other, trying to get to the highest ground. It must have been really ugly at the end. And I talk a little bit about that in here. But there's very few human fossils because a lot of the humans were buried last and they weren't buried deep enough to be a fossil. So most of the humans probably rotted away near the surface or in the very shallow surface. And there's been 4,000 or so years since the flood and an ice age. And so there's been a lot of erosion of those shallow layers as well. So there are a few human fossils, but just not very many because humans are probably the last thing to get buried in the flood. Yes, come on up. Don't be shy, even though you don't have a mask on.
How did the dinosaurs go extinct then?
I couldn't hear you. How the dinosaurs what?
Go extinct.
Oh, how they go extinct? Well, that's a very good question. I think, like a lot of animals that we see today, like the dodo bird and things like that, and the carrier pigeon, you know, I think humans might have had a hand in it because they were killing these dragons. You hear about these legends of knights killing dragons, but the dinosaurs couldn't grow as big, I don't think, after the flood. I think the environment and the oxygen level and the CO2 level in the pre-flood world was vastly different than after the flood. So it's almost like you went from here in Texas to high up in Colorado and tried to run. You know, because there's not as much oxygen. After the flood, I think a lot of the atmospheric oxygen levels changed, so dinosaurs couldn't grow as fast. And there was cold areas. In the pre-flood world, I believe the whole world was a global greenhouse. But in our world today, you have most of the warm reptiles live in the near the equator. They don't live up in Canada. They don't live in extreme cold areas. So the dinosaurs had to live in a more narrow range after the flood, and they might have interacted with humans a little more, and so there might have been this, you know, humans going out killing them, young men like yourself going out showing off to the girls, I'm gonna go kill a dinosaur, because they didn't get that big. Yeah, that took them a lot longer to grow to those big sizes. It might have taken hundreds of years to get that big. So if you kill a T-Rex when he's little, it's still impressive, but it's, you know, not as hard as trying to kill a big full-sized one like that. But I think eventually that it was kind of long-term climate change because the pre-flood world was so different than the post-flood world. That we did see a lot of interaction. Like I said, the Egyptians apparently saw them, the Cambodians apparently saw them. There was lots of evidence in Europe of tapestries. And if you look at the tapestries, the legs come straight down. Different than all reptiles today. So why would they paint them that way? Why would they draw them that way? You know, they must have knew what they were doing because they saw them. And it's very, very consistent when you look at these drawings and carvings. Secular world just says, oh, that's nonsense. Don't believe any of that. But art is a way to communicate. You know, there's a lot of truth to that art, and even in the biblical text and other writings. Marco Polo supposedly saw dragons on his adventures across China. Those might have been the last of the dinosaurs before they went extinct. You don't find the bones of dinosaurs after the flood because they didn't get buried. So they rotted away. So there's no evidence bone-wise of dinosaurs after the flood because you need the flood to make the fossils. Without the flood, you don't make fossils hardly. Does that answer your question somewhat? The answer is I don't know. It took a few thousand years because we do see evidence of some interaction, but I don't know why other than I think long-term climate change. Just like the panda bears are on the verge of extinction because they're losing their environment and dinosaurs kind of lost their pre-flood environment, so they were more susceptible to going extinct, and they eventually all did.
That's a great question.
Okay.
Yeah, one
tough
more.
Question.
Time for one more. Come on up, buddy.
It's a very tough question, very good question to ask, but not a good answer.
Let's see.
Did the ones that eat meat eat like plants and stuff while they were also eating meat?
Probably did. Because we do see that in the alligators and crocodiles today. You know, if you, the biologists that dissect and study reptiles today, crocodiles and alligators, they're still cutting them open and finding bones of animals, but they're finding lots of vegetation there as well. And so they probably were eating vegetation. I think some of the plants that are extinct that we see as plant fossils might have had highly nutritious value in them. And so in the pre-flood world, dinosaurs could survive eating certain plants. But those plants also probably went extinct after the flood. And so that's another reason why a lot of the animals started eating each other. But God's original design, which will be the, when he creates the new heaven and new earth, there'll be no animals eating each other. You know, we'll just eat plants.
So we got one more. Good question, buddy. I love that.
Those are good. You guys have been listening. See, not everybody fell asleep during my talk.
All right, last one. Here we go.
I like to see the little kids asking.
What's your favorite dinosaur?
My favorite? Well, this is one of my favorites over here, Triceratops. But my favorite is Stegosaurus, with the big fans, you know, the big plate sticking up on its back. And I got lucky enough to find a Stegosaurus plate in Wyoming when I was digging dinosaurs. A little bitty one, up my, probably by the head about this big, and I was, that made my decade. Longer than you were alive, it made my whole 10 years of digging, and it was pretty cool. Then somebody stole it. So I was supposed to get a copy of it, but a guy stole it.
Well, thank you so much. And thank you, everybody. We're so grateful that you came today. Will you be out in the foyer?
Yeah, I'll be out there for a while, and I'll be back tomorrow if you have any questions you didn't get to. I may stir up a few more questions tomorrow when I talk about the flood.
We'll have some more Q&A time
tomorrow. Q&A right afterwards at noon or whatever tomorrow. We'll have time.
We can all stand to our feet. I just want to dismiss in prayer. One more time, can we give it up for Dr. Clary here? And Father, we thank you for this evening. We thank you, Lord, that we were revealed truth today, Lord. And we pray, God, just as your word says, that, God, the truth will set us free, and we're grateful for that. Lord, we pray that you would just, God, bless those on their way home. Bring us back together tomorrow. In Jesus' name, amen. We'll see you tomorrow at 10 a.m. Don't forget, if you have an offering, you can drop that off in the back. Also, any of your communication cards. God bless you. Hope you stick around. You're welcome to come and take pictures here on the stage of these dinosaurs. We just ask that you just don't touch them so they don't break. And also, out in the foyer, there's an opportunity for you to take a selfie out there with a display that they have out there. God bless you. We'll see you tomorrow morning.